Lyndon is the Vice President, Executive Vice President, and Chief Custom Officer at United Airlines. A student athlete, Wildlet Rensselaer, she was a four-year winner and captain of the women's basketball team. She received a bachelor's degree in computer science and a master's degree in industrial and management engineering. Joining Dr. Schmidt and Linda JoJo at Sarah Rice, Lipsy Hurst, hockey captain, Riley St. Ange and RBI's captain, Kyle Hallbauer.
Good evening, hockey fans, and welcome inside the Houston Fieldhouse on the campus of Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute in the city of Troy in the heart of New York State's Capital Region. It's time once again for RPI Engineers Hockey here on ESPN+. This evening, the Engineers look to follow up their season-opening victory last night against the Mercyhurst University Lakers. The teams do battle once more here in the Capital Region. Alongside the coach, Dan Fridgen, Dan Ball with you here, and we welcome you once again to RPI Engineers Hockey. And coach, a lot to like about what we saw from this Engineers team a night ago.
Yes, they got after it as soon as the puck dropped, scored 34 seconds in, and then went up 2-0. Maybe a minute and a half later. So a very fast start for them. You'll be looking for a better start for Mercyhurst tonight as they're going with Lent, the guy that replaced Harmon last night. Lent is starting. So, you know, you're just looking for RPI to come out, play to their identity that they played to last night, and we should be okay.
Between head coach Dave Smith, Jacob Lee, and Ryan Mashey, who spoke to the media after the game, all three talked about the identity at length. We'll get into that later on in this one. But we're ready to go for the opening faceoff here between the Engineers and the Mercyhurst Lakers. John Beaton, Carson Briere will take the opening draw. It's controlled by Dalton Hunter of the Lakers. The Engineers will go from right to left across your screen. They have Jack Watson in goal, who made 32 of 35 stops yesterday en route to his first victory of the season. Controlled in the near corner. Beaten one of three red sweaters on that one. Nick Strom, Mason Klee on defense for the Engineers to start. The top line of John Beaton, Jake Gagneau, and Brendan Booty on the ice on offense. On the other side, it's Matt Lenz in net, the sophomore netminder out of Calgary. Here comes Beaton, and he missed the net. Past the far side is nearly beating Lenz on that first chance. Adrian Bisson, Brendan McCallion, then the top line of Briere, St. Ange, and Hunter. Starting for Rick Gotkin's group, he's in his 35th total season between all three divisions, leading this team to a grand total of 564 victories in his time. Dave Smith in his sixth year, 52, 88, and 12. Onto the far side here is Lee. Hallbauer bunts it down and kept into the far corner. Heidemann takes a hit towards the numbers. No call as both officials keep their arms down for this one. Officials William Brennan and Anthony Dapuz with Nicholas Gauvin and Brendan Wormley, the two linesmen. Behind the cage here is Massey. Back for Agnew, who's able to keep it in at the line. It's chipped off the glass, but not out. The puck will spray back behind the cage. Norton and Cade Townend, the two defenders out now for the Lakers. They play catch, allowing both teams to change. We're a minute and a half into this one. No score between the Engineers and the Lakers.
That's a good point that you made there that I forgot to mention it last night with regard to Coach Gotkin. He's in his 35th year, and he only needs 12 more wins for that 600 magic number.
Absolutely amazing what he's been able to do with this program in terms of longevity and also just the advancement of the program as a whole. Getting not only to the Division I level, but also competing for Atlantic Hockey titles. Here's Garagosh, a shot that one missed the far post. Competing for league titles, making it to the NCAA tournament on a few occasions. Long stretch pass, looking in front. Herman's able to bunt it forward for Walsh. They're joined by Mazzotti, but all three will go for a change.
Well, you can tell he's got a lot of character. His teams usually reflect that character as well.
Watson makes the glove save, and he'll hang on. We'll have a stoppage of play 2.5 minutes in. The game last night, Coach, a 6-3 victory for the Engineers of RPI, and the storyline in that one was Jacob Lee, his five-point night to open up his season, 2 goals and 3 assists. The last time that this program saw a five-point game, Evan Terenese, I believe is how you would say it, back in October of 2016. Ture Linden, the last time that this team also saw a 3-assist game back in February of 2020 before, well, the world stood still. So an incredible game for Jacob Lee nonetheless, looking to build on that one here tonight.
Yeah, Coach Smith saying that, you know, he could expect that kind of offense from him. He has the capabilities. Lee does, but he certainly had a special night last night.
I found the comment that he made about elite practice habits to be very interesting, as this one's popped up in the air into the defensive zone. Bisson, the first one on it, flanked by Mazzotti, but it's chipped along the far boards. Elite player habits, or practice habits, not necessarily something you can teach, as Klee shoots it off the side of the goal and wide. Ardanaz at the near point, sends it on goal, deflected, never got all the way to the net. Brackett covering the far point, his pass gets deflected up in the air. Out to the center line, and Klee will regroup with Ardanaz, the two defenders for the Engineers. Now it's tipped in, and Jake Gagneau will go and chase. And it's also probably when you're recruiting players into your program, Coach Fridgen, that you can't necessarily tell practice habits. You see a lot of stuff in games, but it's hard to see, will this player put in the work every single day to get better?
Yeah, and I think there were times where if I was on somebody and I happened to be out watching their games and they practice the next day, you'd slide over and catch practice just to see what their work habits are like.
Sure.
But, I mean, you know, practice is where it all starts. And if you've got good practice habits, those are the things that are going to carry over to a game situation. And let's face it, it's human nature to always look for shortcuts. And it's no different than football players, hockey players. You know, you just want to make sure that you're putting in an honest day's work, because that will carry over to game situations.
Puck is sent all the way down, and we'll see an icing against the Engineers. Sustained pressure there from the Lakers in the early going. The shots on goal through the first 4.5 minutes, 5-0 in favor of the white sweaters, but still a game that's tied at nil. Faceoff will be to the left of Watson in the defensive zone for the Engineers. It's Beaton against Reifenberger. John Beaton won 14 of his 21 draws last night. Overall, the Engineers won 40 of 70 en route to their 6-3 win. Dave Smith saying after the game he doesn't normally notice the crowd, but it was the crowd and specifically the crowd behind the Engineers bench, the student section, that really motivated him, motivated his team, and was a factor in last night's game, as Heidemann has it in the near corner. He fights off a couple of his former teammates, the transfer out of Mercyhurst, a player that was tied for the team lead in points a season ago, making the jump, as some would say, from the Atlantic Hockey Conference into the ECAC. Surdy sends a backhand feed for Hallbauer. Now here comes Lee on the near side. Pokecheck lands, finding the trailer coming. Here's Hallbauer, fakes it, now takes it, and it goes right into the catching glove of Lenz, and he'll hang on.
Not a tough save for Lenz, but he's on his game right now. He didn't have much traffic in front of him and just wanted to get the puck to the net. Never a bad idea. First shot on goal, actually.
Lenz made 19 saves on 20 shots and 29 minutes and change in relief of Tyler Harmon, who picked up the loss yesterday. Started the first three games of the season for this Lakers team. Now a record of 0-3. He gave up 4 goals on 12 shots. Lenz in the crease now to our left as the Engineers control off the draw. Here is Surdy on the near side boards. Backhand feed goes to the point. Hallbauer was rushed by it, but eventually it's still kept in at the line. Sent back the other way. Pass out of the reach of Dom. He and Hallbauer go 1v1 into the far side boards. Pulled away for the moment by Burns. But he was stripped by Surdy. Good defensive play. It's taken to the center line by Herman. He will chip it off the end boards and send it in. Here's Walsh behind the cage. Was looking to find Herman once more, but he was still caught below the goal. 2-on-2, they rush back the other way. Burns will chip it into the near corner, allowing some of his teammates to go for a change. Stolen below the goal, past nobody home, kept in at the line by Norton. A good play on the backhand. He advances below the goal, was able to upend Ardenas along the way. He's now taken a full tour of the offensive end, but loses the puck in the process. Kyler Head will whip it into the far corner. Chipped along there by Agnew. He'll send it off the glass and all the way down. Brackett in a race for the puck. He will beat Cade Townend into the near corner and avoid a hit in the process. Good hustle there by Brackett. Springs it loose for Evans behind the cage. Taken the other way, advanced through center. A chip play trying for Head on the backhand. His backhand doesn't connect. Puck rings around the boards. Garagosh unable to keep it in at the line. And now going back to get it is Philip Waugh. One of four players with connections to the Brooks Bandits junior program in the AJHL that had monster nights in last night's game. Big hit late at the line as Waugh's taken down. Chipped high up in the air by Klee. Here's Mazzotti on the near side. Tried to go to the backhand. Very similar move to a goal that we saw Mazzotti score last weekend, but he's unable to get it all the way there.
Yes, he was going for another one of those long reach goals, but he's got a different netminder in there that didn't take the bait.
Sent on goal from the near side point by McCallion. It's gloved down and held on by Watson. I tell you what, if Sutter Mazzotti ever takes a shot in a shootout, I feel like we have an idea of where he might try to go.
Exactly. I played with it. Well, this is an old pro, but Bobby Smith played for the Ottawa 67s, had a similar move because he had such a long reach.
And sent below the goal. It's an elusive move. I tell you, if you can get a goalie to bite on that shot on your forehand, you get it out to that backhand. I mean, there's essentially nothing you can do.
Exactly.
Far side point. Bisson keeps it in. McCallion sends to the far side corner. Good stick lift there by Surdy. Knocks the puck free on the far boards. High off the glass and into the defensive end. They'll ring it right on back. The point about the Brooks Bandits, you had four players in total. Jacob Lee an alum. Of course, we talked about his five-point night. Ryan Mashey had two goals last night for the Engineers. James McIsaac, who is not in the lineup in tonight's game, did have a goal last night. And then Philip Waugh on defense for the Lakers, a goal and an assist. So that all coming from Nathan Crosby, who works in the business department of the Bandits. Pretty nice night for the Brooks alums, and that's a program that spit out a number of incredible talents, notably Cale McCarr of the Colorado Avalanche with ties to the Bandits program out in Alberta. Sent to the point, Agnew unable to keep it in at the line.
Yeah, well, I'll let that shot go from the pointer. Remember that? That was a laser.
We heard the shot, and then we saw a bunch of players in white sweaters cheering, but anything before that was nearly impossible to see, at least from our vantage point. It was a bomb. And that was a big goal at the time. It was the third goal for the Lakers. It cut it to what was then a two-goal lead after RPI had a lead of as much as four. And the empty net goal from Mashey, his second of the game, was able to salt things away. Here is Smolinski at the line off the end boards, too far ahead for Lee, and the race is won there by Maziarz, who is into the lineup tonight on defense. Joseph Maziarz, the senior out of Waterloo, Ontario, icing against the Engineers. Three changes in total for the Lakers. In addition to Maziarz going in, which sent Jake Bonet up to the metaphorical press box. Tommy Bannister, Eric Esposito out. Brian Coughlin, Tyler Gallin in on the fourth line. And again, the only change for Dave Smith's group. James McIsaac out. Altti Niekanen in on the wing with Rory Herman and TJ Walsh. Wouldn't necessarily want to be making a lot of changes to the offense, and 11 out of the 12 players back in the lineup here today. Long flip ahead, just ahead of the sprinting Hunter, but he's able to find it. Sent back to the point on goal. That one goes wide. Kept in at the line by Garagosh, deflected in front, but it goes right into Watson. And after the play, Keenan Stewart giving a bit of a shove to Herman after the battle in front. We'll have a stoppage with 10:19 to go in the first period. No score.
Yeah, what's interesting about this line, you got Walsh and Niekanen are both left shots, so one of them has to play the offside. And it's a freshman, Niekanen.
Face-off controlled by the Engineers. Ardanaj tried to force it up the near side, but it would not go. Both defenders on that near side turned over in front. Here's a chance on goal, deflected wide. Good back pressure coming from Walsh on Coughlin, who was the one who was nearly the beneficiary of that chance.
Yeah, turnover there in the D zone on the breakout for RPI. They were lucky to get a stick on that shot.
Advanced up the far side. Here's Coughlin at the line. He'll chip it off the glass and in deep. Here comes Strom ringing around the near boards, finds Brackett on the near side. His quick slapper goes wide. Brings its way off the end boards and all the way back out to center. The Engineers will try once more. Deflection there by Brackett, just a little too far ahead of Mazzotti, and instead, Matt Lenz will fall atop the loose puck. 9:27 to go, opening period here in Troy. No score between the Engineers and the Lakers of Mercyhurst. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN+.
Hi, I'm Andy James at Rensselaer Honda, and this is my buddy, Bo. Looking to sell your car or truck? We want to buy it. Are you looking for a great used car? We have a huge selection. That's why Rensselaer Honda has been your Honda dealer for 44 years.
RPI Hockey is back. Contact the Houston Fieldhouse box office at 518-276-6262 or boxoffice@rpi.edu to watch your Engineers in action this season.
For the love of the game, the team, or for two, Recovery Sports Grill. At Recovery Sports Grill, you'll always have courtside seats to exciting live sports coverage. And for outstanding loyalty perks, join our Hall of Fame, Recovery Sports Grill, serving up smiles every season.
9:27 to go, opening period here at the Houston Fieldhouse. No score between the homestanding RPI Engineers and the visiting Lakers of Mercyhurst University. Dan Ball, Dan Pridgen with you here on ESPN+. Thanks so much for making us a part of your Saturday evening. Shots on goal in the early going, 7-2 in favor of the visitors. But, Coach, have you noticed any real imbalance in play in the early going?
No, it's been pretty even both ways. Not a lot of sustained offensive pressure by either team off the forecheck. So, I mean, they're playing it safe, breaking out of the zone pretty easily.
Faceoff will be in the offensive end for the Engineers to the right of Matt Lenz. Lee and Briere will lean in on the draw. Puck is down, controlled by Lee. Agnew on the left point, cross for Strom. His shot goes wide. It died for Heideman there as he was waiting on that far side post. Lee wins the battle. Strom on goal, right into the catching glove of Lenz, and he will hang on. We mentioned it a few moments ago that all players and coaches that were mentioned in the media yesterday all talking about the identity of this team, and Dave Smith saying specifically to make plays, go with pace. They want to be hard to play against. They want to be a team that possesses the puck. That's a lot of what happened yesterday as a pass from Agnew goes through the crease all the way into the defensive end where Hunter will give chase. Things that definitely came through, especially in the early going, but everyone who spoke to the media did admit that it looked like the Engineers let off the gas just a little bit. Backhand feed, or backdoor feed rather, going for Massey did not connect. Back to the point, Hallbauer. Now cross for Strom, who's had a long shift. His shot goes wide. Lee in pursuit on that near corner. Townend able to knife it free. But Massey's going to go in on the forecheck once more and nearly win it. This time it's turned over and taken down there on the far side was Heideman. Neither referee in this one with their hand in the air, so both teams playing on in the early going. Booty had it for the moment. It's taken back the other way, brought in by Reifenberger to the far side for Hunter. Backhand feed blocked in front. Hallbauer had it for the moment. Never got all the way in on Watson, though, and it's taken over the line and brought through center by Beaton. Beaton to the far side, a shot from Gagneau. Blocker saved by Lenz. Sent the rebound out towards the middle, but nobody in red able to find it. St. Ange at the center line will send it the rest of the way. Gloved down by Watson, who leaves it for Surdy, and the Engineers will begin their breakout once more. Surdy through center. Here is Beaton, sends to the far side, too far ahead for Gagneau. Philip Waugh was the first one there. Now he's the one with possession. And RPI will go for a change. Everybody who spoke to the media did admit the team kind of let their foot off the gas in the late going as that one's turned away by Watson. It's something that you mentioned as well on that far side. Two players on either side looking for that loose puck. Sent off the glass by Klee out to center. This one will go all the way down and will be icing against the Engineers. You noticed it when it was happening. Everybody talked about it. The first 50 minutes, probably exactly what the Engineers wanted, but the end of that game, finishing the full 60, maybe not so much.
Yeah, I mean, they had dominated up to that point, and you have a 5-1 league. It's, like I say, sometimes it's human nature to just sit back, but, you just got to, regardless of what the game situations are, what your lead is during the game, you just got to continue to play with consistency.
Klee backhands for Ardanaz, who's met by two white sweaters, but he's able to pull it out of harm's way. Long pass ahead finds Mazzotti. He goes one-on-one against McCallion. The shot is deflected off the glass. Up and out of play, and we'll have a face-off in the offensive zone for the Engineers. And you're right. No matter what the game situation is, you could be winning by four, you could be losing by four. It's consistency. It's keeping to that game plan. It's keeping to that culture. That's the mark of a winning team at the end of the day.
And that's the mark of your identity. No matter who the opposition is, you go out there and play your game. Because generally, somewhere along the line, you're going to realize that that game and that you play to that identity, you're going to have success with it. And I'm sure that's what Coach Smith harps on a daily basis.
Smolinski at the point after the win by the Engineers. Isra's shot deflected up and out of play. Caught a piece of Keenan Stewart on the way through. They'll do it all again to the right of Lenz, who is 5-for-5 in the early going for the Lakers. Herman, Walsh, and Nikkanen. The latter of the three, like Dan Fridgen mentioned a few moments ago, playing on his offhand. McIsaac, who was on that right wing yesterday, a right-hand shot, so playing on that natural side. But again, you see some of the most elite goal scorers in hockey today playing on that offside. Stepping in is Agnew, his shot blocked. He finds it once more, looking for a pass in front. D Didn't connect with Herman. Now it's taken in by Dom on the right side. Stick lift there by Burns, but a good deflection off the glass there by Herman, sent towards the goal and wide. Back up top. Stewart unable to corral the pass. Niekanen has it at the line and out. Now here comes Herman, one on a few on the left side. His shot goes up and over the net. Roy Herman getting a chance to put his team on the board first. Brought ahead by Hallbauer to the line. He'll send it the rest of the way. Herman, who's had a long shift with this group, was in and had the chance to corral it, but he could not. Instead, it's Heidemann on the far side. Poked loose from Ashy, kept in by Hallbauer. Sent below the goal, so Heidemann can forecheck on that once more. He absorbs the hit from Townend. To a side, they scrap. It ends up finding the man that was sitting on the outside of the scrap, and now it's sent the rest of the way. The Lakers will go for a change. On the near side, here is Lee. Goes one-on-one against Norton. His backhand feed looking for anyone. Unfortunately for the Engineers and their fans, it found no one. And now the Lakers will look for an escape. 5:25 to go, first period here in Troy. No score. Engineers and Lakers in a non-conference battle. Feed finds Coughlin. His shot deflects off the glove of Watson and up and off the end glass. A good chance there using a defender as a screen, too.
Yeah, that one just sailed a little wide. That was a good quick shot using the D as a screen.
Waugh's backhander kept in by Strom at the line. However, he was unable to repeat that success. A collision there right by center ice after the puck had left the zone and went off of Gagneau, who took a little while to get up. He'll go for a change. It was all happening behind the play as Strom was going for that loose puck. It looked like Gagneau got the worst of that one.
I think both players were tied up and one was got a little bit better of the other.
Pass in front was looking for St. Ange, would not go. Now it's Mazzotti for the speedy bracket. He absorbs a hit as Dustin Garagosh was able to catch him. He's forced to send the puck in deep. Agnew unable to keep that one in at the line. It'll go all the way back below the goal for the Engineers. So a near miss there in transition as Agnew was unable to keep that line. Ardenaz for Agnew. He'll send it. Well, he tried to send it in. It caught Mickey Burns, who was just coming off of the bench. A tough way to start that shift for him. Now here's Mashey. Near side advances over the blue line. He had it knocked free, but Evans keeps it in. Shot by Mashey once more. Glove save, and Matt Lenz will hang on. 3:49 to go, first period here in Troy. No score, RPI, and Mercyhurst.
So Mercyhurst is in Erie, Pennsylvania.
Yes.
And you have the major junior team, the Erie Otters.
Sure, former home of Connor McDavid.
That's right. Other than the most snowfall in a day, what else is Erie, Pennsylvania known for?
Oh, boy. I know a lake. I know a canal. Other than that, I don't know much.
Yingling.
Oh, man, that should have been the first thing in my mind. It is a Saturday night, after all. Lee has it below the goal. There's something I know about Yingling, but I didn't know that. Lee sends it on goal. Lenz is able to find that one and make the stop. I do remember a time when Yingling was only a Pennsylvania thing. It was only sold there. You couldn't find it anywhere else. I don't know when they started to expand, but it was during my lifetime, so it wasn't that long ago. But I do remember that about Yingling. I did not know Erie, though.
Yep, Erie, Pennsylvania. Actually, on that last shot, RPI unfortunately hit their own guy. Otherwise, it was into an open net on that shot from the point.
Gagneau lays his stick to the ice. He's able to keep that puck in. Looking for a backhand pass. Was booty towards Beaton. It wouldn't go. Waugh is met by Beaton and booty. Stepping in from the point is Surdy to keep that in. He'll reverse it back down low for booty. Booty A-frames is met by Mazziars, who again checked into the lineup tonight after not playing in game one yesterday evening. The other way come the Lakers looking for a backdoor feed, nobody home. Beaton tried to get it over the line. He had a streaking Gagneau, but the pass would not go. Kept in by Burns, who's trying to lose Surdy near the top of the point. The defenseman ends up winning The battle gets it to Booty at the line, who will send it the rest of the way, and Brendan Booty is dumped over the boards. Mickey Burns lost his stick. He didn't need it at the end of that one. A big hit on Brendan Booty.
Well, when you're going to make a line change, there's no better way than to have help.
Here comes Herman for Niekanen on the far side. He sends on goal, and he scores! At the end of the day, Dan Fridgen, they're all snipes. But unfortunately, it looks like Niekanen might have hit an edge after he scored, and the players are quickly calling for the trainer in that near corner. So the engineers take a 1-0 lead, but we may still have more to come.
Yeah, right here, he catches a referee, and I think he, right here, you're going to see he was already down, and he caught something. It looks like the inside of his knee. But yes, Lentz wishes he could have that one back. I think it rolled up his stick and off the bottom of his blocker. And tough goal to give up late in the period, but it's better than early in the period like happened yesterday. He was already down with on one knee, and I think that's what happened because it looks like it's his right knee.
Oh boy, it's never a good sign to see a player who cannot put any weight on any particular leg, and he's going to be helped down by a couple members of the engineers down their tunnel.
You know, it's interesting. Ooh. And that probably wouldn't have happened had he not celebrated. And I can remember a famous player, Hull, who would not celebrate any goals whatsoever. Number one, because he didn't want to show up the opposition, and he just wanted to do it quietly so that maybe he can get another one and not bring any attention to himself.
He was assisted by number 16.
It's a very interesting philosophy, I tell you, and we'll look back in hindsight and who really does know. Mashey able to take it over the line. He walks in, shoots, save, rebound loose in front. Knocked down there was Lee. Penalty coming up against the Lakers. Stepping in is Klee. He shoots and Lenz makes the save, but a penalty will come against Mercyhurst. Mashey took the shot from the far side. Lee was going to the front, as was the third member of that line, Heidemann, and all three are exchanging fist bumps because though they didn't get the second goal, they do get a power play out of it.
Well, RPIs, that goal's, they've come to life here near the end of the period. And there it is right there with the takedown.
It'll be Tyler Gallen who will sit for two for cross-checking there on the back check. Inauspicious start to the weekend for Gallen, who didn't play yesterday. The power play will get started for the first time for the engineers tonight. They were 2-for-3 yesterday, both goals coming from Jacob Lee on deflections in front. So keep an eye out for him in front of Matt Lenz. Agnew tries to go backdoor. His pass was deflected, and the puck sent all the way down. The power play last season for the engineers, clicking at 20.3%. Last weekend, 1-for-5. The cumulative power play effort between Colgate and the University of Toronto. Here is Agnew on the right side, but his pass is stolen by St. Ange, who is taken down and will now skate 4-on-4 aside as the penalty taken there to keep St. Ange from going on at least a partial breakaway, and the power play is negated 31 seconds in.
That was a good call for interference. And that Hull that I was referring to wasn't Dennis, wasn't Bobby, but Brett Hull.
There's a look at the replay, and you're right, Coach. That is, in terms of obvious penalties, probably right at the top of the list, as Smolinski will be the one that sits for two. It is indeed an interference call against the freshman Smolinski. Faceoff controlled by the Lakers in their offensive end. Here's Norton. Shot is deflected to the corner. Hallbauer goes one-on-one. It's taken away by Briere. He's on his backhand, looks in front, and they score! Cade Townend stepped in from the point and got a backhand feed from Carson Briere. And just 11 seconds into the 4-on-4, the game is tied at 1.
Well, that was a great play by Briere. And what usually happens in four-on-four hockey is that everybody's responsible for somebody. In the defensive zone, the forwards are responsible for the D, and the D are responsible for the forwards. And you, as you saw, he came from the point uncontested all the way in. A great feed by Briere to find him.
Townend's first goal of the year. He led all Laker defenders last year with 7 goals as well as 16 total points. So a guy that this team typically leans upon for offense from the back end.
And I was thinking, too, you hadn't been calling. Sorry, I was thinking that you hadn't been calling Briere very often.
No,
at all, you know.
I did expect more. And, you know, you see the name when you're preparing for a weekend. And then you look at the numbers attached to it, and, oh, we're going to see him flying all up and down the ice. Not necessarily the case, and it's not necessarily his fault either. I mean, the team has shown to this point that they're a little top-heavy in terms of their offense. So if you shut down that line, you may shut down Briere. But anyways, we'll see if he can do it again as he carries in over the line. Finding man coming late, it's Mazyars. Now into the near corner. Burns in front, was looking for Mazyars, who stepped in. That pass would not go. Here is Burns behind the net. He's already made a number of friends on this Engineers team. Going to the backhand and send it on goal. There is Garagosh. It deflects up and goes out of play with 40.7 seconds to go. We skate 4-on-4 for the remainder of the period.
Good play by Strom there, the defender for RPI. He certainly got beat body-wise, but he was able to get that stick on the shot, which deflected it up and over into the netting.
A pair of 19s, Mazzotti and Dom, will lean in for the draw. Poked towards the middle, a pass coming from Stewart. Didn't find either of the defenders out for the Lakers. We're at the 30-second mark here in the opening period. A game that is tied at 1. Altti Niekanen, the first goal, and then a goal from Cade Townend stepping in from the point. Tied it at 1 apiece. Now here comes Hallbauer leading a 3-on-2 with a couple of trailers. Backhand feed finds Mazzotti. Look to send it in front. Pass deflects out to the line, and Surdy will have to take it back to center. 7 seconds to go. Lauri Surdy over the blue line and in. A shot turned aside by Lenz. Rebound controlled by McCallion behind the cage. And the clock will hit triple zeros at the Houston Fieldhouse. We went the majority of the way with no scoring, but a couple of goals in the period's final minutes. Sees a game that's tied at 1, shots even at 11, score even at 1, play in your mind even as well.
Yeah, I thought it was pretty even. However, I thought RPI, after they scored their goal, got the momentum, but what took the wind out of their sails was a call on the defenseman, which was Smolinski, and Mercyhurst ended up tying it up.
Score after 20 minutes of play, Engineers 1, Mercyhurst University Lakers 1. Plenty more to come here on ESPN Plus, but Dan and I will step aside and be back with more after this. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN Plus.
We are boundary pushing change agents. We do what it takes to make things happen together. It's our collaborative spirit that sparks creativity and pushes us to think beyond ourselves. We're scrappy and unabashedly enthusiastic about our passions and projects. We are hardwired for the havoc of change. We know it isn't easy, that theories can fail and world changing can feel futile. But that's the calm before the brilliant storm. The breath you take before you break through. Small change comes from asking why. Changing the world comes from asking, why not? That's the question we ask everyone, from freshmen to faculty. It's the question that fuels us to find the next new. The question we ask you, why not change the world?
I'm Andy James at Rensselaer Honda, and this is my buddy Bo. Looking to sell your car or truck? We want to buy it. Are you looking for a great used car? We have a huge selection. That's why Rensselaer Honda has been your Honda dealer for 44 years.
It's the most historic conference in college hockey. It's a battle night in and night out. ECAC hockey, an iconic conference home to 12 of the most prestigious universities and programs in the world, and showcasing the best student athletes in the sport. Top-notch facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions. ECAC hockey, there's no experience like it.
RPI Hockey is back. Contact the Houston Fieldhouse box office at 518-276-6262 or boxoffice at rpi.edu to watch your Engineers in action this season.
For the love of the game, the team, or for two, Recovery Sports Grill. At Recovery Sports Grill, you'll always have courtside seats to exciting live sports coverage. And for outstanding loyalty perks, join our Hall of Fame, Recovery Sports Grill, serving up smiles every season.
RPI Hockey would like to thank the following sponsors: Moe's, the Hildenberg Man in Troy, Septic Division of Broadview, CDPHB, Virginia Clark Financial Group, Market 32 by Price Chopper, Yankee Trails, Red Front Pizza, Tri-City Rentals, Ben and Jerry's, Warren W. Fame, CDTA, Virginia Clark Benefits, Wicked Smart, Tri-City Valley, Rensselaer Alumni Association, Nitro Companies, Pepsi, Jolene Morris of Howard Hanna Real Estate, all proud sponsors of RPI Hockey.
A few moments away from puck drop for the second period of play here at the Houston Fieldhouse in Troy, New York. The score after 20 minutes, the RPI Engineers tied at one goal apiece with the visiting Lakers from Mercyhurst University. Alongside the coach, Dan Fridgen. Dan Ball with you here on ESPN Plus. Delighted to be part of your Saturday night in the Capital Region and beyond. As we get ready for a second period of play, we'll have exactly 1 second of four-on-four action with the penalties that carry over from the opening period. Then the Lakers will get 31 seconds of power play time, and then we'll go back to five-a-side, assuming that the Lakers do not score. And coach, we talked about it right after the end of the first. Very even on both sides, but after the first goal, because we didn't really see any action on either side till about the 3-minute mark remaining in the first period. Once RPI got that goal, it looked for the time being like they might grab control of this one.
Well, they started moving their feet, especially on the forecheck, and then going to the net, drawing a penalty, and now going on the power play. The momentum was in their favor, and it was the perfect time to capitalize on the power play, but unfortunately, an interference call. Good play. I mean, you know, you don't like to see it, but hey, it was going to be a breakaway. Otherwise, can't go 0 for 2 on the offensive blue line. The puck was already by Smolinski, and then the player tried to go by him, and he had to do something to take him down.
Puck is down at center. Rory Herman took the draw and slammed it into the defensive end for the Lakers. So that kills off the first of the two penalties. Tyler Gaulin is out of the box. He's the one with the puck, sending it into the corner. 15 seconds remaining on the penalty as this one's backhanded up and out of play. Three quarters of the way up the stands. I tell you, at this pace, we're going to get one into this booth at some point. I don't know when. I don't know against who. I don't know where. One of us is going to have a souvenir by the end of this season. We'll see where she goes. Faceoff will be to the right of Jack Watson.
This is where the power play statistics become skewed, because even though there was only, 17 seconds on RPI's power play earlier before they went 4-on-4, that counted as a power play, just as this 12 seconds counts as a power play for Mercyhurst.
St. Ange rips it on goal, saved by Watson. He controls his own rebound. There's still 1 second remaining on the penalty to Smolinski. So the scoring coming from Malti Niekanen. He was able to ramp one up. Matt Lenz's stick and in the back of the net at the 17:44 mark. Rory Herman, Kyle Hallbauer, the assist on that one. But then 59 seconds later, Cade Townend potted a backdoor feed from Carson Briere on the 4-on-4. That tied the game at 1. In between that, penalties to Gaulin and Smolinski, both of which have now concluded. We're back to 5-a-side as a pass coming in front, deflected by the stick of Serdi, up and out of play. So 38 seconds into the second period, we'll see our first 5-on-5 faceoff.
And I tell you, I'm just watching Watson on that play. He's down, taking away the lower part of the net. He's got his paddle on the ice, so that's leaving the top shelf open. He had no idea where that puck was.
Serdi rings it along the boards. Mashi allows it to get back out to center. That's where Heidemann finds it. Puck ends up rebounding its way into the defensive end. Watson, 10 saves on 11 shots in the opening period. On the other end, Matt Lenz, 11 for 12. Lee sends across ice, a little too far for Heidemann. He'll go and track it down against Townend. Here is Mashi on the far side boards. Thinks wiser of using his point, instead uses behind the net where Heidemann was waiting. Stepping in at the point is Serdi to keep it down there. Heidemann is met below the goal from Briere. I had to check my notes. I wasn't expecting to see him A, down there, and B, laying a physical play. He did both, and now he has the puck. To the trailer, it's Hunter, and backdoor feed looking for Briere from St. Ange, and a good last-minute stick, knocking that puck loose. That would have been an open net for Carson Briere.
That was a nice tic-tac-toe play, but again, you want to shoot those pucks when you get those opportunities.
Puck controlled behind the cage by McCallion. So are you advocating for St. Ange to shoot on the right side there?
Yeah, because you got Briere right there on the doorstep. He's on his forehand going to the net. He's there for a rebound.
There for the rebound. Very underrated part of the offensive game in hockey as Ardanaz pops it up in the air. Adrien Bisson stepping in from the point for the Lakers. He's the one who has it now. Shot on goal, blocker saved by Watson. Rebound glove down by Gagneau, but the call from the near corner saying that was moved a little too much. A hand pass called against the Engineers. Faceoff will go into the defensive end just 2 minutes into period number two.
So Watson goes from not making a stop at all because the pass just jumped over Briere's stick to the possibility to have to make two saves if St. Ange had shot that puck.
Controlled behind the net. Jonathan Bendorf, the one in on the offense, as the puck was played for the moment there by the Lakers. Now it's controlled on the far side by Reifenberger. John Beaton in there, as is Nick Ardanaz. 2-on-2, they battle. Sent to the point for Waugh. Cross point shot coming, save made. Rebound and a kick stop made by Watson. He found the first shot and then was able to snag that rebound with the pad. Now here's Beaton in on the near side, goes to his backhand, and a shoulder save made by Lenz. Brendan Booty will ring it back behind, allowing Waugh to give chase. Gagneau lays the hit and tries to knock the puck loose. Instead, it's skated over the line by Mazziar's puck sneaks its way through Strom, allowing Bendorf to maintain possession. It's 23-23. It's won by the 23 of the Lakers. Fedulov getting one of his first shifts. He was the one who had possession for the moment. But it's taken the other way this time around by Klee. Brackett on the receiving end from Strong, but the pass was in his cates. At the line, deflected in by Stewart, 3.5 minutes into the second period. A game that is tied at one. Townend feeling the pressure from Evans, whips it off the near boards, kept in at the line by Mazzotti. And then Mazzotti laid a hit and he shoots. It's deflected up and out of play.
Thinking about buying or selling a home.
A hand in the air will have a penalty. I believe it's coming against Mazzotti.
Yeah, I think he caught, after he took the shot, he caught the defender there in the face with a stick. I think it's Dom. Actually, he's a centerman. Dom got a stick on it, but I think he caught the high stick as well.
There's the view of Sutter Mazzotti in the box. You can kind of see us a little bit if you look very closely, right below the R, the last R in Rensselaer. And you know what? If that's all you can see of us, that's enough for me. Power play on the ice for the first time for the Lakers this evening. Controlled by St. Ange at the left point. His pass rolls harmlessly into the corner, but he's able to find this one below the goal, marked by Surdy. Briere up top for McCallion. Now Briere once more unable to corral that pass. He and St. Ange switch places. Briere rings it all the way around the boards. Too far for anybody except for Hallbauer. He was unable to get it out. Kept in at the line by McCallion. Briere across. A drive and a save. That shot coming from the near side from Mickey Burns. Now McCallion once more. St. Ange steps in. Ripped on goal. That one deflected up and goes out of play. Never get on to Watson. We'll have a stoppage after 39 seconds of power play time and 4.5 minutes of game time here in period two. Power play yesterday for the Lakers was 0 for 1 so far, 0 for 11 this season. Last season, 30 for 135, 18th best in the nation. Here is Norton, walks his way to the center line. That shot blocked in front. That one's blocked as well. Bendorf shot blocked by Nick Strom, who went down, laid out, and got at least something on that shot. Here's Norton reversing once more. Controlled at the line by Fedulov. He has it once more. Townend on the near side. In front, Bendorf on his backhand. Tried to find Fedulov. Puck still loose. Good move by Norton. To the backhand goes Bendorf. Backdoor feed deflected away by Strom and clear the rest of the way down.
Tell you what, Strom has a good stick. He's taken away those passes just by having a stick on the ice in the passing lanes defensively.
Townend over the center line, the goal scorer in this one for the Lakers. Brings it all the way around to the far side, kept in by Norton. Now here's Bendorf covering. Townend down low, looks for a backdoor feed. Nobody home. Brackett chips it around. He's got a partial 2-on-1. If he can win the race, he does. Here is Brackett, and he shoots. Blocked, loose in front for Evans. Unable to get a stick on that one with a good enough angle to shoot the puck, but the Engineers will get possession back with 10 seconds to go on their kill. Brackett will wisely send it in on Lenz and go for a change. The power play comes to a close for the Lakers. The Engineers now 1-for-1 on the kill. They were 0-for-2 last weekend. And their two opportunities on the penalty kill against Colgate. Did not see a kill against Toronto, so starting to get things moving in the right direction on the kill. That was seventh best in the nation a season ago. Delayed offsides here against the Lakers, so all of the white sweaters will have to escape over the blue line, allowing Surdy to escape over as well.
You got Heidemann out there filling in for Nikkanen, who's injured.
He is with Walsh and Herman, and it is Herman who last had possession of that puck that will rebound up and out of play. And you can see the very exuberant student section behind the bench of the Engineers. That's going to be a fight for that puck.
So there's a Mercyhurst player that kind of, I smile every time you call his name.
You do?
I think of the Honeymooners.
Is this going to be a guessing game, or are you going to tell me?
It's number 8, Norton. And the reason why it's a Honeymoon is because if I'm a forward on the Mercyhurst team, I'm wondering, do you call, hey, Norton, when you want the puck? That was awful, wasn't it?
That's not for me to say. That is for the court of public opinion to decide. An icing called against the Lakers. Now I'm going to laugh every time I hear it. The true casualty, of course, being me. Face-off to the right of Lenz.
It actually took me a period to tell you because it happened right in the first period.
We almost made it through it together without it, but now here we are. Here's Booty coming in on the far side. He shoots, deflected off the stick of Bisson, up and out of play. Face-off will be to the right of Lenz with 13:09 to go in the middle period. Feel free, just shout those out whenever those come to mind. No reason to leave us in suspense.
Well, you're pretty young, so I don't know if you're familiar with the Honeymooners and Jackie Gleason.
I'm just smiling in my and nodding my way through this conversation.
Exactly.
You never know. Every now and again, especially for talking music, as the Boys Are Back in Town plays, fans very excited about that concept during family and reunion weekend, reunion and homecoming weekend, rather, but families are always invited. To the defensive line, backhand by Ardanaz gets up to center. Now here's Klee leading a partial 3-on-2, looking to find the trailer, no one home. Pass goes to the empty space that's defended by Ardanaz. Now here's Lee at the line, backhands into the far side corner. Mashey will ring its way around the boards for Heidemann. He was expecting a defender there. Strom was just getting on the ice for Klee in a change. Ardanaz will backhand it high off the glass and into the far corner. Lee helps it along the way. Heidemann steps in, looking for Lee. His shot doesn't get all the way through. Now Burns will take it, and a 2-on-1 with Brackett trailing. Finds the trailer. His shot goes over the top of the net. Aided along by a stick of the defender who was in the way of that one. Lee will send it towards center off the skate there. Found by Strom, who's up in the offense. Strom scored in the scrimmage against Colgate, the first unofficial goal of the season for the Engineers. Seeing eye shot from the left point.
They got lucky there. Mazzotti was all alone in front of the net.
Evans takes a hit to send it to the point, but it's picked off and taken back the other way. Good defensive play with the stick there by Agnew. That was going to be Tyler Gallin, who would have had a partial breakaway at least if he maintained possession. That shot gets blocked by Evans, who came whipping his way through the slot. It's that same player, Evans, who takes it over the line, but he had the puck knocked away, led back along by Waugh. Over the blue line and in, he shoots, blockered away by Watson to the near corner. At the point, picked up by Reifenberger at the center. Bisson whips it to the middle, shot on goal, goes over the top, rebound off the end glass, picked up by Reifenberger once more, and he skitters it along the ice into the waiting pad of Watson, and he'll hang on, nearly 9 minutes gone by in period two.
Not a bad shot by Waugh, but clearly his forte is the one-timer.
I tell you, if I had a shooter like that on defense, there's at least always a spot on the power play on his weak side. Puck is deflected nicely by Gagneau. Partial 2-on-1, backdoor feed. A little too much heat on it for TJ Walsh, and the puck deflects up and off the end glass. Back the other way comes Bisson. Inside-out move, a shot on goal, saved by Watson. He went heavy into those end boards, but's able to get up after going feet first into it. Center line, McCallion all the way across and in deep. Good chances on both ends for both teams as Watson will hang on.
So it looks like Coach Smith is rotating guys through on the right side there. That time it was Gagneau.
A very impressive debut for, season debut rather, for junior forward Jake Gagneau. A goal and 2 assists for 3 points in yesterday's victory. Didn't see action in either the scrimmage nor the exhibition, nor did Rory Herman. But Gagneau scored on what was a very responsible play, too. He was covering at the point for, I believe it was Jack Agnew, stepped in right at the top of the circles and beat Tyler Harmon clean. Goal scorer's goal if there was one. Deflected in front of the net, never got all the way to Lenz. A saucer pass deflected by Heidemann. Watson finds it before St. Ange can. Around the boards, it's picked up by Heidemann. He backhands for Lee. They lead it over the offensive blue line. Sent on goal, save made, rebound loose. Knocked to the near corner there by Surdy. Long pass ahead finds Hunter, but he was unable to have the puck sit for him. Centering feed, Briere got a backhand on it, but not enough to send it on net. He deflected it to the near corner instead. Briere finds it once more, finds a man coming late. He shoots, save made, rebound in front. Watson finds that one, and it ends up on the stick of Ardanaz behind the net. A great response there by Watson after the first save to find that rebound.
Good play by Briere again. He's right in the thick of it offensively.
We didn't talk about him all that much in game one, as Dan mentioned earlier on in the broadcast, but you always feel his presence, and now he's really starting to knock on the door. An assist today, an assist yesterday as well.
As you mentioned, a better save by Watson.
Watson has been outstanding in this one to this point. Far corner, they battle. Keenan Stewart, the one who's trying to knife it free for the Lakers. Booty takes a man down, Garagosh. Hand stay by the side of the officials. Drive from the point coming, deflected. Watson didn't see it originally. The puck squirts past the far side post after a lot of contact. Booty sprays it to the middle. A knuckling puck gets out to center. Here is Gagneau. Shoots around Watt, goes up above the net and out of play. And we'll have a stoppage with 8:43 to go in the second period. A lot of end-to-end action, but only two goals between the two sides at the half point in this one. It's RPI 1 and Mercyhurst 1. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN+.
It's the most historic conference in college hockey. It's a battle night in and night out. ECAC Hockey, an iconic conference home to 12 of the most prestigious universities and programs in the world, and showcasing the best student athletes in the sport. Top-notch facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions. ECAC Hockey, there's no experience like it.
RPI Hockey is back. Contact the Houston Fieldhouse box office at 518-276-6262 or box office at rpi.edu to watch your engineers in action this season.
.843 to go, second period here at the Houston Fieldhouse, and you saw it on your screen during that commercial break. Make sure you join us out here at the Houston Fieldhouse for one of 37 possible opportunities to see both the men's and women's program, rpiathletics.com, for tickets and more information. Drive by Smolinski and a blocker saved by Lenz. He's Dan Fridgen. I'm Dan Ball. We're on ESPN Plus, and we thank you for joining us here on this Saturday evening for some hockey in the Capital Region. Evans on the far side, advances over the blue line, but he's met by McCallion, and a big hit laid there by Brackett. He took an elbow near the cage area while he was going to try to help support that puck. No worse for wear on either side there, as Smolinski's able to advance it to the offensive blue line, but Bisson's the first one there. He keeps the puck pinned for the moment. At the end of the day, it's found by Mazzotti. Taken to the line and in by Strom. Looks to center a feed. Brackett couldn't find it in his skates. Here's Strom once more. He scores! Nick Strom from the top of the circles gives the Engineers their first lead of the night.
Well, he just shot that puck high because he knew Lentz had to go down and cover low. And the delayed, I watched him release the puck. I saw it go in, and then it was a delayed reaction before his arms went up. And the horn going off, and then they realized he scored. Nice, quick shot.
Well, Strom was the one who you can thank for getting that offensive possession started. He brought it over the blue line. His pass to Brackett didn't quite go, but he was able to find that loose puck in. A goal scorer's goal, to say the least, from Strom, the sophomore out of Dayton, Minnesota, transfer from Western Michigan, gets his first regular season goal. We mentioned that he scored in the scrimmage, and it was a very similar kind of shot. He was shooting high, and he was able to kind of get a seeing eye shot through in that scrimmage. That was not necessarily a seeing eye shot, but it was a goal scorer shot, that's for sure.
Yeah, he's got that down pat, shooting from the point, going high, picking corners.
Speaking of shooting from the point, that's exactly what Cade Townend did, but Jack Watson able to find that one. Strom was a member of the Western Michigan Broncos last year, but did not play. So his RPI debut yesterday night was also his first RPI regular goal. Season action in college hockey, despite being a sophomore. He was the captain of the Fargo Force the season before in the USHL. 5 goals, 13 points in 40 total games. So coming from a good junior program, but Western Michigan wasn't the fit. It appears that this RPI Engineers program may just be. Maziar sent it on goal. The puck up in the air. The rebound is loose, and it's waved off by the official directly behind the net. Watson was down on his backside as the shot from Maziar's popped up in the air behind him. I wonder if we'll see a replay from that one or possibly a review, because even if it didn't go in the net, it certainly got close.
Yeah, it looked like it came up, popped out, and went down his backside. Couldn't really tell from here.
Well, I saw the puck being scooped back either across the line. Should give a bit of a better idea. Just kidding. Jack Agnew was there blocking the view, and before we get a chance to get any reviews, the play continues. Watson makes another save. The shot coming from Waugh on the right point. The rebound was there as well. Gagneau will skate it over the center line. Beaton avoids a big hit coming from Gallin. Instead, the hit comes from Agnew, who steps up, finds Gagneau on the near side. He steps in and shoots, missed the net on the near side. Round off the end glass, found by Booty with one hand. He centers off the skate of Booty in on Lenz. He'll pin it against that far side post and get a stoppage. Good chances on both sides, even without that first chance going in. Another chance from the point, Philip Waugh getting it started.
Yeah, he did a great job getting that, getting back on that rebound. Seems to be leaving a few rebounds, probably more than what he would like to leave. Watson, of course. But he's there for the rebound and making the save.
Face off to the right of Lenz, controlled by the Lakers. Taken over the line and in by Burns. Keenan Stewart will win the race against Mason Klee to find that puck, but he turns it over. Mashey had it at the line for the moment, but McCallion pokes it back in. Here's Burns in front, taken away, and skated out of harm's way by Lee. One-handed pass, and now it's on the stick of Heidemann, who stays onside. But a good active stick there by Burns. Knocks it loose. They'll have to try again. Mashey towards the net, looking for a deflection from Lee. Instead, he gets a save. That one made by Lenz. Kicked away with the left pad. Bisson skates it through center. That one's knocked away. Good defensive play. Backhand lob finds Heidemann on the near side. He will, instead of taking the shot, take it behind the net. He's met by Brendan McCallion. Jack Brackett fresh off the bench. Now Mazzotti in the near corner. Mazzotti is met by Bisson, and though the former has the height advantage, the latter ends up putting the puck away. Mazzotti will say thank you for taking it from me. Via a hit in front of the engineer's bench, the puck now back in the defensive zone. Where it's skated up by Hallbauer. To the near side, it's Evans looking for a man in front. Now he'll stop and shoot. Blocker save, rebound loose. Knocked to the near side where Surdy has it. He hits the brakes in the near corner. Mazzotti on the side looking back door. Pass was intended for Evans. It was deflected up in the air by Hunter. St. Ange for Briere, who has Townend jumping in on the rush. Briere looks to go back door. Hallbauer able to knock that one free. Below the goal here is St. Ange. Tried to whip it on net. Hallbauer blocks that one as well. He tries it once more. And Watson able to keep that one. And now Hunter will get a couple shoves from Lori Surdy after trying to poke the puck loose that wasn't necessarily there. Things will be de-escalated by Govan and Wormley, the two linesmen, and with 5:02 to go in the second, everyone will be escorted back to their respective bench.
Well, I think he's given him a penalty for slashing. That's going to be Hunter going to the box.
You can hear the delight from the crowd here on the side of the broadcast booth right behind the engineer's bench. It will indeed be a slash against Hunter. Dalton Hunter, the graduate forward out of Greensburg, Pennsylvania. Took a penalty last weekend against Ohio State, so second straight weekend he will sit.
Penalty for number 18, Dalton Hunter. He receives 2 minutes for his time of the penalty, 14 minutes, 58 seconds.
I mean, I could see him doing something like that if the puck was loose, but if it was covered, it certainly not what he deserved.
Power play is 0-for-1. Sent to the point, kept in. Now it's Walsh near side, and a save by Lenz. He came out above the crease to meet him. A big hit laid there by Waugh on Walsh after the fact. But the netminder for the Lakers able to keep this deficit at 1. Power play on the weekend for the Engineers now, 2-for-4. Looking to make that 3-for-5, and it's Lee in on the draw, won by the Engineers. Smolinski at the center point. Here's Agnew, a drive and a kick save. Walsh tried to find that, but instead it's scooped all the way down by Waugh. And the Lakers will get changes to their penalty killers. Here comes Smolinski gaining speed behind the net. Now finds the trailer Walsh over the center logo here at the Houston Fieldhouse. But before Walsh is able to gain the line, it is called offsides.
Smolinski's got to watch that. After he gives the puck back in the neutral zone, he tries to pick that top forward of Mercyhurst, who's on the forecheck.
Dave Smith will change power play units. Beaton, Booty, and Heidemann. Surdy and Mashey, the five on the ice. Advanced over the line by Mashey on the near side. Now Surdy walks the line. Back for Mashey at the right point. Protects on his backhand. Surdy once more. Slap pass for Booty on the left. He steps in and shoots. Save made. Rebound loose in front. Trying to find a man there. Beaton. Lenz is pushed backwards into the net. But he was able to keep it out no matter what. Good chance in front for John Beaton, but Matt Lenz makes another save on the kill.
Good thing that was a quick whistle, because Lenz ended up being pushed over the goal line with the puck between his legs, which wouldn't have counted anyways.
Well, there were three white sweaters that were draped on top of Beaton. You could see on that replay, he was able to get it at least on goal and then was strong on the stick, to say the least, to try to escort the netminder across the line, but Dan Friggin is correct. Wouldn't have counted either way. Can't necessarily use your stick in quite that manner. Knife to the line and out to center there. Surdy will have to regroup. Here's Booty, who will ring it around the end boards to the near side. Waugh fires it past Mashey and then by Surdy and then all the way down. Surdy is marked by Reifenberger, but he's able to sprint by him. He drops it back for Heidemann. Now it's Beaton to the far side. Booty. Beaton once more. Beaton knocks it loose. He's taken to his knees, and the pass didn't connect with Surdy. It was the other of the two units for this team that got on the board with two power play strikes last night. Both deflections by Jacob Lee, two of his 5 points. Heideman finds it in the near corner, bunts it back for Booty, who says, no, Heideman deserves it more. Sent to the point for Cleese, and on goal, looking for a deflection there was Booty. He didn't quite get it. Strawn knifes it down in front of the defensive blue line, and now it's Mazzotti who sends it back into the near corner. Under three to go, second period, 2-1 Engineers. The goal coming from Nick Strom right above the right circle. That shot blocked by Strom. He wore a shot coming from Hunter right in front of him. Puck squirts by Briere. Mazzotti sends it back for Strom, who will pop it off the end boards, but it's stolen back away by St. Ange. Mason Klee finds that loose puck first, sends it off the end glass. It will skitter its way down, but will be called no icing. Dalton Hunter does end up winning the race. St. Ange extends the neutral zone. It goes off the skate of Hunter and in deep. Ardanaz takes a big hit. He's able to get it up the boards. Now it's Evans skating it in, going backwards now forwards, sent across the crease. Hallbauer was in on the offense, but the pass was too far for him. Mazzotti lets it go for Brackett in the far corner. Now it's Evans who is met by Owen Norton. Norton to the point. Ardanaz will choose to send it into the corner. The Engineers establish their forecheck, but before that happens, it's taken away by Briere at the end of a long shift, but he'll take it into the offensive zone himself, sending a pass back, looking for a trailer, did not connect with head. TJ Walsh at it for the moment. He can't find it. Ardanaz takes another big hit from head. Puck to the point. Townend's shot gets blocked. Stepping into the point is Garagosh into the far corner. He takes a couple of hits. Eventually, the puck is knifed loose there by Hallbauer. The Lakers regain once more, but a pass there is deflected. Ardanaz off the glass. Mazzotti tries to advance it over the line. He cannot. The Lakers able to keep the puck in the zone. We've reached the final minute of play here in period number two. Garagos's shot gets blocked. Walsh tries to knock it free. Looking for a backhand shot there by Garagos. That one goes in on Watson. He makes the stop. Garagos once more short side. Missed the net high. To the point, Gall in. Gets it around Evans, center point shot by head, saved by Watson, and he'll hold. And the Engineers will get a much-needed stoppage of play with 35.7 seconds left.
Well, good pressure here late in the period by Mercyhurst. I've just been looking, watching, and thinking they're playing a lot better than they did last night. I think that's, you know, why we have such a close game here.
Very much so. It did look like, especially at the beginning, and you kind of made this comment towards the end, that the bus legs hadn't quite been shaken off by Rick Gotkin's crew, but they definitely did as the game went on, and that's carried over into some very strong play by Mercyhurst, who also leads on the shot board, at least at the Houston Fieldhouse on the scoreboard, 30-24. And Matt Lenz has been very, very good in net, save for the first goal that he would probably want back. But anyways, here comes Agnew through center. He leads the rush on the right side, takes a big hit from Bisson. Puck below the goal with 16 seconds to go. Bendorf finds a man on the side. It's brought over the center line. Too far for Bisson. Here's McCallion on goal. Save. Watson rebound loose in front. Still loose. It's knuckled over the line. This one will go into the defensive end with 3 seconds and two. And the clock will run out on the second period of play. The crowd on hand at Houston Fieldhouse disappointed that they do not get a free taco from Moe's, but excited that their team leads 2-1 after 40 minutes of play. And you're absolutely right. Very tight checking, back and forth action, but the Engineers able to get on the board and they lead this one after two.
Yeah, and you know, real good shot by Strom there to go up 2-1. Simple play, put it on net. So far, that's the difference.
Shots on goal in this one through 40 minutes of play now, officially 31-24, but Jack Watson, 30 saves on those 31 shots, and he's led his team to the lead after 40 minutes of play. Dan and I will be back with the third period after this. 2-1, Engineers over the Lakers. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN+.
Right, so the typical competition is up and ready to go. If you purchase a puck, please.
Hi, I'm Andy James at Rensselaer Honda, and this is my buddy Bo. Looking to sell your car or truck? We want to buy it. Are you looking for a great used car? We have a huge selection. That's why Rensselaer Honda has been your Honda dealer for 44 years.
are boundary-pushing change agents. We do what it takes to make things happen together. It's our collaborative spirit that sparks creativity and pushes us to think beyond ourselves. We're scrappy and unabashedly enthusiastic about our passions and projects. We are hardwired for the havoc of change. We know it isn't easy, that theories can fail and world changing can feel futile. But that's the calm before the brilliant storm. The breath you take before you break through. Small change comes from asking why. Changing the world comes from asking, why not? That's the question we ask everyone, from freshmen to faculty. It's the question that fuels us to find the next new. The question we ask you, why not change the world?
RPI Hockey is back. Contact the Houston Fieldhouse box office at 518-276-6262 or boxoffice@rpi.edu to watch your engineers in action this season.
It's the most historic conference in college hockey. It's a battle night in and night out. ECAC Hockey, an iconic conference home to 12 of the most prestigious universities and programs in the world, and showcasing the best student athletes in the sport. Top-notch facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions. ECAC Hockey, there's no experience like it.
For the love of the game, the team, or for two, Recovery Sports Grill. At Recovery Sports Grill, you'll always have courtside seats to exciting live sports coverage. And for outstanding loyalty perks, join our Hall of Fame, Recovery Sports Grill, serving up smiles every season.
Just about ready for the third period of play here at the Houston Fieldhouse in the city of Troy on the campus of RPI. Back here on ESPN Plus, the score after two periods of play. The homestanding RPI Engineers a 2-1 lead over the visiting Mercyhurst University Lakers as we go towards period 6 out of 6 in regulation between these two teams this weekend, and the Engineers looking to sweep their opening weekend of play. Alongside the coach, Dan Fridge, and Dan Ball with you here on ESPN Plus. Delighted to be with you here on this Saturday evening. And coach, we talked about it off the beginning of the broadcast. Yesterday, the team played extremely well for the first two periods and into the third. Then towards the end of the third, maybe things started to soften up a little bit, the foot off the metaphorical gas pedal. So a very good learning opportunity here in front of this team.
Yeah, no question. And you know, with your Mercyhurst coming out for the third, you're on the road. You're only down by one, so it's only going to take one shot. What RPI has to do is maintain the consistency that's gotten them to this point with the lead, not sit back, and they have to get the puck deep and forecheck, you know, start some cycling, get some offensive opportunities, and execute.
All of that possibly still to come. While we have a moment, just a quick update. The RPI women's program dropped a game this afternoon at Providence College. The final score there was 2-0. They are back home next weekend against, of all teams, Mercyhurst. Games at 3-2, respectively, on Friday and Saturday. Give you some other scores in the ECAC going on this evening in a few moments, but before that, Briere advances for St. Ange, who sends it back below Watson's net. The Engineers going from right to left across your screens here in period number three, led ahead there by Gagneau. Knifed up by Klee, looked like for the moment it may jump up into the bench, but it decided against it. Instead, Briere had it, but then lost it. Here is Evanson over the line. He shoots, saved by Lenz. There is no rebounds.
Well, good thing for Briere that he had two defenders following him up there on the turnover. And it was only a two-on-two. He picked up the back checker.
Some scores around the ECAC. Union dropped a game in overtime to UConn down in Hartford, Connecticut earlier today. Also going on, St. Lawrence trailing UNH 2-1 at the start of the third. Clarkson leading Merrimack 2-1. Send into the far corner. First one there is Mazzotti, who will turn it up the boards to the line, but not out. Kept in by Reifenberger, but it ends up spraying itself over. It's blocked by Mazzotti, led into the zone here by Evans on the near side. A shot and a kick save by Lenz. Rebound to the near side corner. Good bit of back checking there by Mazzotti to block that pass right in front of the RPI bench as Surdy sends it across. Hallbauer on net, kicked aside by Lenz to the corner. On the near side, Brackett has it knocked free by Reifenberger, but now Mazzotti, that second wave of offense, able to find it. He protects by turning every bit of his 6'6" frame into Marco Reifenberger, but the puck ends up getting loose, and that's when Cade Townend decides to send it into the corner and go for a change himself. We're a minute 45 into period number three at the Houston Fieldhouse in Troy, 2-1. Engineers with the lead as the play goes offside. We'll have a faceoff just outside the offensive end for RPI. So far in this one, Matt Lenz for the Lakers, 22 of 24, two periods played at least. Jack Watson outstanding to begin this one, 30 saves on 31 shots through two periods of play. The difference maker in this one, Nick Strom's first career regular season goal, that one coming at the 12:03 mark of period two. Goal comes unassisted as Strom had entered the zone, found Jack Brackett, puck got loose, it ended back up on the stick of Strom, sent on goal, missed the net wide. That's not what Strom did. He found the net. Top corner over Lenz, that gave the Engineers a 2-1 lead. That's where we sit as Smolinski pulls it off of the near side boards and advances it into the corner. Heidemann a backhand for Mashey, who is defended there by Waugh. Eventually it's knocked free by Garagosh. He sends it off the boards and out to the line, and eventually it bounces its way over. Heidemann will calm things down for Smolinski, who didn't realize Ryan Mashey was going for a change, and that will lead to an icing call against RPI.
Which means that Mashey has to come back out on the ice.
Dave Smith was the one who on the bench walked over and said, does he have to? The official Brennan said, yes, he has to. And Smith gave a quick little shove of encouragement out to Ryan Mashey, so he's on the ice now. Lee, Mashey, and Heidemann. Smolinski and Agnew, the defender, shot off the draw, blockered away there by Watson, a nice stop. To the center line, Mashey will gain the offensive blue line and send it into the corner. This time he'll go for the change he was looking for. Out to the line and brought in by Head, but it's poke checked away nicely by Mason Klee, who was playing on his offhand but was still able to make a nice defensive effort on that one. Back to find it is Bisson, but in the process he sends it into his own bench, so the faceoff will come back into the offensive end for the Engineers just over 3 minutes in to period number three.
I had a chance to tell Coach Godkin that I like the look, his casual look behind the bench.
Did he appreciate it?
Yeah, you know
I
what?
I hope he did.
And we were right in what our thought process was. He said it started during COVID, and
really?
He's kind of kept it going. I've seen some coaches wearing sweatsuits, you know, open collar look.
Has two gentlemen who are going with the button-up but no tie look currently. It's a nice way to go. It's a nice way to spend a night, I'll tell you that much. Here comes Briere. He sends it off the far side boards, but it was only as far as Klee. Now here comes Booty, his backhand feed too far behind Beaton. Pass deflected in by St. Ange, who heard the footsteps coming from Ardenaz. Gagneau wheels and fires off the end board. That's knocked down before any threat of icing there by Norton, who will use the security behind his own goal and advance it up for Hunter, but Ardanaz is able to knock that one free. Booty tries to knock that one loose, as does Gagneau. They're met by both Hunter and Briere. Now it's beaten at the other end of that one. Tries to shoot through the legs of Norton. It ended up getting blocked. You can see that Norton took a few moments to shake that one off. Gaining the center line and sending in deep there is Hallbauer. Giving chase is Rory Herman just off the bench. Big hit laid there by Hunter. It's going to draw a penalty as Ryan Mashey was the one on the other end of it. That's going to be an interference call as Mashey was cutting to the middle. He caught a hit without the puck, and the Engineers will go back on the power play up by a goal.
Yeah, clearly interference. I don't think he was even involved in the play.
Dalton Hunter will sit for two. He's taken the last two penalties in this one. A slash on goaltender Jack Watson back in the second. Now he'll sit for an interference call. The power play back on the ice for the Engineers, 0 for 2 thus far. Lee matches up against Reifenberger. The faceoff controlled by the Lakers, kept it nicely by Smolinski for the moment, but Cade Townend will send it all the way into Watson's glove. He extended outside the net to be able to knock that one down. Walsh at the line, fires around the end boards. First one there, McCallion, it bumps over his stick. Here's Agnew on the far side. Hits the brakes, looking for a passing lane. He'll send back down for Walsh, who's met by McCallion. No real room for the Engineers to work the puck, but now they get some. Stepping in is Agnew. He shoots, glove saved by Lenz. There is no rebound with 4:51 gone by in period three.
Agnew would want to keep that puck a little lower so that you get at least a rebound. There was no traffic in front of the net. Lance had a clear view of that puck. Easy glove save.
A bit of a mixed bag unit going on the ice currently. Herman, Evans, and Mazzotti with Ardanaz and Hallbauer. Effectively a third power play unit if you're keeping track in your depth chart at home. Here's Mazzotti on the far side boards right in front of the Laker bench. Tries to backhand it low. Nobody home, though, and it's fired off of the boards and all the way down. Philip Waugh, the one who cranked it the rest of the way.
Well, it's a good opportunity for Coach Smith to see some other guys out on the power play that don't usually get an opportunity.
Hallbauer brought it as far as the blue line. This puck is now loose for Ardanaz, who steps in. Sends it the rest of the way into the near corner, backhanded along by Dom. And the rest of the work done by Waugh once again, who fires it in on Watson from the other end of the rink. Led ahead by Ardanaz, the freshman, who did have a couple of really nice shifts in the scrimmage, and he nearly found his way 1v3 through the line of defense. Wasn't able to find the puck on the other end of the toe drag move. Knife to center and sent the rest of the way by Stewart, and this unit will go and get a change. 10 seconds remaining on the man advantage as Smolinski takes it from behind his own goal to the center line and into the zone. Continued by Lee, shot on goal, saved by Lenz. Rebound skitters back behind the net. Smolinski wasn't ready for it. Hunter had it for the moment out of the box. It's taken back by Smolinski and ultimately bunted behind to where Lori Surdy was waiting as that last line of defense. Lee will think wiser of trying to catch that pass. He'll deflect it below the goal. We're 6.5 minutes into the third period. RPI clinging to a one-goal lead, looking to add to it here. Here's Lee behind the net. Looked to force a pass in front for Booty, but that one was broken up. Pass off the near side boards. Brought in by Head with speed to the goal, and a kick save made by Watson. He clamps down on the rebound and stops any other danger from happening in front of the RPI goal.
Boy, that was a great save by Watson, getting the left pad down low. That wasn't shot by the Mercyhurst player. That was a poke check that I think Surdy tried to make. Take another look at it here. He's got the puck. Surdy takes a whack at it, knocks it into the pad.
Great look from our production crew has been continuing to help us build our fantastic ESPN Plus broadcast. Delighted to bring you games on ESPN Plus all season long here from the Houston Fieldhouse. Puck winds up in the O zone, and a good forecheck there by Gagneau knocks the puck free here. Strom, he walks in, and a big block. That one coming from Kyler Head. He put every bit of his frame in front of that one, and he's able to keep Strom from sending one on goal. But a few moments later, Tyler Gallen whacks the stick out of Mason Klee's hands, and the Engineers will head back to the power play.
Well, back in the day, it used to be the player's fault for not hanging onto the stick too strong, not being strong on your stick. Now it's a slash.
It'll go to Tyler Gallen. He'll sit for two, fourth power play opportunity. Gallen in his first game of the season. He's been on the score sheet, but not necessarily the way he would have wanted. The freshman out of Kingston, New Hampshire. Two penalties in what is actually his career debut, not just his season debut. Beaton drops back for Booty, who rings it along the end board. Stepping in there is Mashey to advance it along to the point kept in by Heidemann. He finds Booty, passed just a little too far ahead of him. There was a lot of room for him to walk in if that puck was on target. Booty steps in, finds Heidemann, who wheels to the top of the zone. His backhand feed goes directly between Mashey and Surdy and out to the neutral zone. Engineers would certainly love a power play goal to extend their lead. Heidemann sends it along the end boards, but only as far as Philip Waugh, who sends it the length of the rink, and the Lakers will get a change on the penalty kill.
Yeah, if you're the Lakers, you want to be building up some momentum here. You're down by a goal. You're in the third period on the road. And, of course, RPI will definitely take the power play. Mercyhurst has to play with a little bit more discipline here.
Here is Gagneau over the line. He sends it along the end board, so a design play for both units to try to switch the ice to whatever has a little bit more room. Gagneau below the goal. Centers for Walsh. Couldn't quite connect. Sent back to the point. Smolinski walks in. Finds a man coming late. It's Agnew, but the puck wouldn't quite settle, and it's sprayed off the boards by Townend and down the length of the rink.
Not a bad look, but just one pass too many.
There is something to be said, not to say that this is a consistent thing, but trying to find the perfect goal versus getting pucks on net. It was mentioned in the post-game press conference yesterday how there's a lot of value in getting pucks on net on this power play. Jacob Lee was the one who said it, and you would know he deflected two of them in the back of the net yesterday as this one sent over Lee's outstretched glove and the rest of the way. Power play comes to an end as Evans can't quite catch the pass. You saw on the top left of your screen a great look at the guilty party leaving the box. We'll look to give you other fun picture-in-picture views like that throughout our broadcasts. Along the near boards, Norton pulls it off the wall. Sent from the point, Mazziarz's shot gets blocked. Left for the trailing Evans, backhand feed for Mazzotti. He finds a man in front. Strom was stepping up on the offense, though Jack Brackett was slamming his stick on the ice, the trailer. He might have had a better look, but Strom was the one who was on the other end of that pass. Strom able to knock it free away from St. Ange, and now Mason Klee to center and the rest of the way helped along there by Mazzotti. Pass coming from behind the net will miss everybody and will instead find the opposite end of the ice and be an icing against Mercyhurst.
That was a good back check play by Mazziarz, the defenseman. Take that play away, staying on his check with RPI attacking the net.
Herman, Booty, and Walsh, the somewhat mixed bag line as the Engineers continue to play with 11 forwards in place of the injured Altti Niekanen, who scored the first goal of the game and was injured on the celebration in a collision with the linesman. We don't have updates. We know it was lower body, very possibly the knee, and he could not put any weight on it when he was being helped off the ice and down the tunnel. So, unfortunately, that is all we know at the current time. We'll provide updates if we get him. Here is Mashey. He goes to the backhand, but a stick lift coming there from Burns through the middle of the slot. There was a battle that was going on there behind the net. It was Herman who was tied up with Garagosh. So the puck that was sent in that direction never got there. A collision that knocked the stick away from Ryan Coughlin allows the Engineers to start their breakout. Taken to the line and in by Hallbauer with speed. Tries a quick shimmy move. He's taken down. The puck will end up in the catching glove of Matt Lenz, and he will hang on. 8:46 to go, third period here in Troy. One goal lead for the home team. It's the Engineers 2 and the Lakers 1. You're watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN Plus.
Hi, I'm Andy James at Rensselaer Honda, and this is my buddy Bo. Looking to sell your car or truck? We want to buy it. Are you looking for a great used car? We have a huge selection. That's why Rensselaer Honda has been your Honda dealer for 44 years.
RPI Hockey is back. Contact the Houston Fieldhouse box office at 518-276-6262 or box office at rpi.edu to watch your Engineers in action this season.
For the love of the game, the team, or for two, Recovery Sports Grill. At Recovery Sports Grill, you'll always have courtside seats to exciting live sports coverage. And for outstanding loyalty perks, join our Hall of Fame, Recovery Sports Grill, serving up smiles every season.
It's the most historic conference in college hockey. It's a battle night in and night out. ECAC Hockey, an iconic conference home to 12 of the most prestigious universities and programs in the world, and showcasing the best student athletes in the sport. Top-notch facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions. ECAC Hockey, there's no experience like it.
.46 to go, third period here at the Houston Fieldhouse. A 2-1 lead for the homestanding Engineers of RPI, who will return to action next weekend, beginning on Friday night at 7 o'clock. Then again on Saturday at 7, LIU and Army, the two non-conference opponents coming in to face. Dave Smith's group is walking the line as Ardenaz, his shot goes wide, backhand feed through the legs there by Beaton, nobody home. Skated in with speed by Head, back or pass for the backdoor trailer. Meanwhile, that one did not connect. So much speed, so little time to process as Beaton takes it back the other way. He takes the hit, but Booty's able to find it along the far boards. Beaton had it for the moment, but he was knocked off the puck. Now it's Head on the near side boards. Extends all the way through the zone there for McCallion, who rings it around the backboards, and he started it in the offensive zone and it found its way back out of the offensive zone. And now Mercyhurst will have to regroup in their own zone once more. Here is Norton below the goal, and the puck is brought in, sent back behind the net.
I was just going to say, Mercyhurst has been doing a good job of getting that puck from the strong side to the weak side, taking the pressure off the forecheck for RPI.
Norton flings it on goal from the point. Easy save with the catching glove there for Watson. They're doing a very nice job all around. And we mentioned it earlier on in this one back in the second period how it was a quick start to the weekend for the Engineers, possibly aided by the fact that Mercyhurst was caught a little off guard. And it doesn't help when Tyler Harmon let up a couple of goals yesterday that he, in all likelihood, would probably want to have back, but they've rebounded and then some and are now just one shot away from tying this one. But time is on the side of the Engineers, and Ryan Mashey will kill a bit more time in sending that puck deep. Heidemann tried to A-frame and find that puck, but he was unable to do so. Heidemann at the line will advance it the rest of the way. RPI content with sending that puck in deep. If nothing else, you're able to forecheck that and find the puck, and at worst, you kill a bit more time as Hallbauer will go back with Surdy. The two defenders converge on that one. Instead, it's the left-handed defender, Surdy, who found it, popped high up in the air. Waugh will have to retreat. He sends a pass off the far side boards where Stewart will fling it the rest of the way. Stolen away by Dom. Puck nearly in front of the goal, but it's cleared away by Hallbauer before anyone was able to get another stick on that one. McCallion all the way through for Stewart, who's knocked to the ice by Hallbauer. Puck returns into the defensive end for the Engineers, where Surdy finds the captain of this Engineers team. Hallbauer wearing the C, Ryan Mashey the A. TJ Walsh, Jacob Lee, the other members of the quote-unquote leadership group here for this team. So while that may not result in a C or an A yet, you never know. It's a very long season. That's one of those things that can always change. Mickey Burns, the transfer out of Vermont, wheels around his own goal, sends it all the way into the zone. He shoots, missed the net wide, but he finds his own rebound in front. They score! Mickey Burns did the first 99%, but the goal will go to Keenan Stewart, and with 5:52 to go in the third, the game is tied at two.
You know, I was just about to say, if you're RPI, you want to keep that puck moving forward. You want to make sure you're in good position defensively. And in that situation, he ripped the shot and got that puck off the glass out front, and you've got three RPI players there. Just unfortunately, they're watching the puck instead of Stewart, who's coming in on the backside right here. Nobody's got a stick, and it's a bang-bang play.
Well, the game is tied at two apiece. Keenan Stewart, the junior out of Elmira, Ontario, had an assist in yesterday's game, now adds a very important goal. Very impressive effort from the speedy Mickey Burns to wheel it from behind his own net all the way through the neutral zone into the zone. He missed the net with the original shot, but had the offensive wherewithal to locate his own rebound, fling it in front of the net, and that's where Keenan Stewart was waiting. And now we have a game that's tied at two. Mazzotti's pass too far ahead for Evans. This one will go for icing against RPI.
Well, you knew that Mercier was going to have to open it up at some point with 6 minutes left, and they were going to have to take some chances, which would leave them vulnerable defensively. But now we got a tie game, and this will be interesting.
Interesting, possibly fun. A lot of superlatives. Whoa, one-timer and a glove save there by Watson. A strategic move there to have Philip Waugh on his offhand on that right point, and he shot it like we saw him do yesterday, but Watson was equal to the task.
Yeah, he got lots on it. Probably wanted to go a little higher. Watson does a good job keeping that glove just above the stretched out pad, which he did there.
You see some players who kind of take snapshots, half slap shots, many different ways to get a shot off that's not a wrist shot. That was a full slap shot and then some. If his stick didn't hit off his helmet, it was certainly close. He really curled that one to shoot. And he got a lot on it, so can't criticize for sure, as Dalton Hunter will get it to the center line and in. We've got 4:45 to go, third period. Game that's now tied at two. Briere for Hunter. Did would not go. Here's Garagosh, a shot. That one's blocked by Booty. Garagosh once more in front of the goal. Now Briere, look for a pass to the back door. That one got blocked. He had Garagosh for the third time on the back door. This time it's Brendan Booty to the line. He will flip it across the offensive blue line in a almost parallel nature, allowing for the rest of his team to change. He wasn't able to gain the center line. Popped up in the air, kept it in the line by Agnew. One-timer, kick save by Lenz. Mashey goes against St. Ange into the far side boards. Agnew unable to knock it down. Ardanaz will go back and grab it. Ardanaz and Agnew, the two alphabetical freshmen on defense here with 4 minutes to go in a big spot for Dave Smith's group. The Lakers get the clear. They're looking for to complete their change. Now Ardanaz wheels behind his own goal. Has his sights set on Mashey, but Mashey wasn't quite available. McCallion was the first one to find it.
Yeah, he kind of telegraphed that pass.
It was, I'm going to pass it. I don't have it. Oh, I might have it. I'll try again. And it would not go the second time either. Bisana, net off the crossbar. Threw a screen and passed Watson, but the iron would not let it go. from the point there for Bisson, who gets inches away from giving Mercyhurst the lead. Kept in at the line. He'll try it once more. And a blocker save made by Watson. Agnew sprays it all the way down past the stick of Norton. This one will go for icing. And a near miss for Mercyhurst to take their second lead.
Well, you can see why those shots from the point, when they go high on a goaltender who's a butterfly style goaltender, they're risky. And he really let that shot go. That was a hard, quick snapshot off the crossbar. And I think Dave Smith's going to take a timeout here.
He will indeed, with 3:07 to go in the third period, in a game that is now tied at two. And you can say from your experience in situations like these, to me it looks like the right time to call a timeout, not only after an icing call, but given how play has shifted halfway through this third period, it seems like a good time to try to settle the group down.
Yeah, it seems like the RPI has quit moving their feet and they're doing a lot of watching Mercyhurst play. And Mercyhurst they're not doing anything fancy. They're just playing the game. And RPI needs to get their feet moving again.
So as we wait to resume play, the scoring so far in this one, Altti Niekanen scored the first goal of the game at the 17:44 mark in the opening period from Rory Herman, Kyle Hallbauer. The game was tied up just under a minute later by Cade Townend from Carson Briere and Owen Norton. Nick Strom gave the Engineers the lead in the second period with his first goal of the year unassisted. But Keenan Stewart most recently scoring from Mickey Burns and Brendan McCallion at 14:08 to tie the game at two. That is where we stand as the faceoff will be to the left of Jack Watson. Shots in this one 37-31, so Watson has made 35 saves thus far. Not to be outdone, Matt Lenz, 29 saves on those 31 shots. Faceoff was knocked through the wickets there by Dom, but it only went as far as Mason Klee, who was waiting for it. Gloved down there by Townend on the right point. He and Norton paired together on their offhand, but they'll switch back to their strong side. Strom into the near corner, but a near miss there as Dom was looking for a centering pass. Now a 3-on-2 if they can hurry. Beaton finds the trailer. Klee, who was looking back for Gagneau. A great last-second defensive effort to knock that pass loose because Gagneau had some room to shoot if he caught that puck.
And it was lucky Strom got to that puck because there was two Lakers right there, but they overskated it.
Smolinski is met by Fedulov behind the goal. Stepping in at the point is Norton. Kick save made there by Watson. Knocked to the line and brought ahead by Lee. Now here's Mashey on the right. Marked by Reifenberger, and the shot by Mashey missed the net high and wide. Knocked to center. Fedulov off the end glass and in deep. Flanked by both Agnew and Heidemann, sent to the point. That shot gets blocked as Waugh was stepping in on it. Led ahead by the defender, Agnew. He's got Mazzotti to his left. He finds him, knocked towards the net. Agnew tried to get a stick on that one. Sticked away by Lenz. Now a battle ensues on the far side boards with under 2 minutes to go in the third. Taken away by Mazzotti. To the point, Serti. It was on his backhand. He'll activate below the goal. He's met by one defender. Sent behind the net for Brackett, who tried to find an advancing Mazzotti. The pass would not go. Mazziar's backhands to the line. Evans kept it for the moment, but it was the aforementioned Evans who's able to spin and send it back deep. RPI forechecking. They force a turnover. Here comes Brackett. Nearly lost his balance, and the shot coming from the top of the circles is swallowed up and held by Matt Lenz.
Oh, Matt Lenz out top of his crease, taking the angle away, takes it right in the bread basket. No rebound.
You wonder what the offense would have looked like had Brackett been able to keep his balance completely. He was unable to do so. But they do get an offensive zone faceoff to the right of Lenz. It's Herman, Walsh, and Gagneau. Faceoff controlled by Herman. Walsh sends to the point. Serti in front, nearly had Herman waiting there, but the puck would not sit for him. Stick lift there by Gagneau, gets the puck free into the near side corner. A collision leads to a puck battle as we hit 1 minute to go in the third. Game that's tied at two, action on both ends. The goal by Keenan Stewart of the Lakers, currently the one that keeps this one tied. Through the legs pass of Walsh. Saucer passed through the zone. Didn't find Herman the first time. This time around, he springs it high in the air. Gagneau looks to forecheck. I believe it might have gone off of Jake Gagneau for the Engineers. And into the bench, the faceoff will be in the neutral zone just outside the offensive end for RPI.
Yeah, just off that faceoff when Surdy took that shot, Herman was wide open in front of the net. Nobody knew where the puck was, but unfortunately it was bouncing.
It's Beaton and Coughlin. The puck won by Beaton of the Engineers, sent the rest of the way there by Klee. Norton sends it along the boards. Knifed all the way down on the play by Gallin. It will go the rest of the way. Strom wins the race to the puck. That is icing against the Lakers. A somewhat bizarre occurrence here for Mercyhurst. Their fourth line currently on the ice in such a big spot with 27.6 seconds left. They'll remain on the ice due to the icing call. It's Beaton versus Coughlin once more to the right of Matt Lenz.
They're already minus one tonight, each of them.
It ends up working in their favor, though, as Head finds a man in front. Brought in by Gallin. He had it for the moment, but lost it. Beaton A-frames into the near corner. Beaton and Strom battling for it. Puck loose for the moment. Below the goal for Head. Poked up top. Townend shot doesn't get through. 6 seconds to go. Whipped on goal. Blocked aside there by Watson. Strom will flip it out into the neutral zone, and we've reached the end of regulation in front of a good crowd on hand here at the Houston Fieldhouse. The game remains tied at 2 after 60 minutes. We will see overtime for the first time this season for the Engineers of RPI. We'll stay with you as we get ready for the overtime period. A very even game on both sides. Coach Dan Fridgen, not as strong of a start, or a stronger start, we should say, for the Lakers, more so than anything on the side of the Engineers. Really good goaltending on both sides. Very tight checking game. A lot to like on both sides. It's just been a good quality hockey game.
I agree. And it makes a lot of difference if you remember yesterday's game. Mercer's got down real early, and that's a tough road when you're on the road. Down 2 goals early in a hockey game. RPI was able to sustain the pressure, get a couple of more. Tonight's a closer game. And as you say, both goaltenders could have gone either way. Both goaltenders have made some key saves in key situations.
37 saves for Jack Watson of the Engineers, 31 for Matt Lenz of the Lakers. Let's talk difference makers before we get into our overtime period here. Who are you looking at for the Engineers? Who are you looking at for the Lakers as players that could end this thing?
Boy, that's a good one. I'm going to take a look at that.
This doesn't need to be a pick, necessarily.
I'm going to go with the lead line is always a good line. The lead line is always a good line, so... I'm going to go with the Lee line.
I like it.
And then you got to go with, let me go with a fourth liner. Let's go with Head.
Wow. Yeah. I like it. I mean, hey, that was the line that was out on the ice with 30 seconds to go. And they were able to not only get it out of their own end, but get a couple of chances in the offensive end. So I like it. I asked for creativity. I was given creativity. No need to laugh at that. We're just about ready to go for overtime here at the Houston Fieldhouse. In case you're just joining us, it's been an outstanding game on both sides between the RPI Engineers and the Mercyhurst Lakers. I'm Dan Ball. He's Dan Fridgen. We're happy to be with you here for the 3-on-3 overtime period. It will be 5 minutes of overtime. It is Lee, Jacob Lee, and Kyle Hallbauer. Rather unsurprisingly, it is Carson Briere and Riley St. Ange on offense for the Lakers. Brendan McCallion, the defender, out there for Rick Gotkin's group. It was McCallion who was the first one to bring it into the zone, but Lee found him. Here is Briere. He'll have to skate it back out to center, feeling the pressure from Brackett.
Well, both coaches going with two forwards and a defenseman.
Often the formula you see the two and the one, and you kind of have the go for it forward and the I'll be back on the back check forward. you can choose at home which one is which. Here comes Brackett looking to get the inside step on McCallion, hits the brakes, looking for the trailer. Instead, he'll shoot, and a save, rebound, loose in front, and Lenz finds it again, the rebound, score! The third time was the charm, and it's Jack Brackett who sends the fans at the Houston Fieldhouse home happy. 3-2, your final.
Well, he is part. Well, that's Mazzotti's line, so I was way off. You know what? That's what happens. They kind of got caught with one guy back, and it didn't look like the Mercyhurst guys were coming back too fast. And he whipped on the first pass, stayed with it, got the rebound.
Jack Brackett, the overtime hero. Kyle Hallbauer will likely get the assist. He was the one who took that second shot. The Engineers are able to stave off the Lakers in their push in the final moments. They win the game 3-2 in overtime and sweep the season opening series against Mercyhurst in front of the crowd here at the Houston Fieldhouse. A very exciting ending to a very exciting weekend. Your final thoughts, Coach, on the first weekend of regular season hockey for this RPI men's program?
Well, you know what? Yesterday was convincing. Today they had to work a little harder. They won it in overtime, so they win both games in different fashion, but they're both W's, and a great way to get out the broom and put it on the wall for the weekend.
The winning net goes to Jack Watson. Jacob Lee will get the secondary assist, so the final goal there is Brackett from Hallbauer in Lee at the 42nd mark of overtime. The winning net to Jack Watson. He is 2-0 on the weekend and on the season. He makes 37 saves on 39 shots to pick up the victory. The hard-fought loss in net to Matt Lenz, 33 saves on 36 shots. So that's going to do it here from the Houston Fieldhouse in Troy, New York. Final score for the final time. It was 3-2, the Engineers over the Mercyhurst University Lakers in overtime on the goal from Jack Brackett. We'll be back with you next weekend for not one, not two, not three, but four RPI hockey games. The women's program and the men's program home at the Houston Fieldhouse. The women will play at 3-2 against Mercyhurst. The men at 7-7 against LIU and Army. And if you can't make it to the Houston Fieldhouse, we hope you'll join us here. For everybody working hard behind the scenes, and for my partner Dan Pridgen, Dan Ball saying good night. You've been watching RPI Engineers Hockey on ESPN+. 6-2. 6-2.